7 p.m. on BBC One and iPlayer.
Now, we're going to talk about tests for coronavirus, and two crucial tests. I need to just spell out the differences. The Have You Got It test, which is otherwise known as the antigen test. And this is the one where they're talking about they've got to get 100,000 of those a day by the end of April, going particularly in the health service. There's then a second test called the Have You Had It test, which is an antibody test, which you can find out if you have had it at some point in the past. And again, that's thought to be a potential game changer if they can bring that online. From the government's point of view, seems a bit less urgent. The World Health Organization and many senior scientists are warning that antibody testing could have a large number of pitfalls anyway. But it would be a simple test that uses a drop of blood from your finger prick to tell us if you've already had and recovered from COVID-19. And if you think about it, it could be incredibly useful for individuals to know they've had it, because they could then go back to work with a bit of certainty that maybe they got short-term immunity. And if they're working with the vulnerable or others in the community or in care homes or whatever, that's going to help them. Meanwhile, the government wants mass antibody testing for a different purpose. It wants a wider and deeper statistical understanding of how many people have had this thing to help plan a way forward. So when are we going to see antibody tests coming online in a big way, being approved? Will they be accurate? Will members of the public have access to them? Will they allow people to move more freely if they test positive, or will they cause more problems than they solve? As I said, we're talking about the Have You Had It test here. Do email vine@bbc.co.uk with your phone number or your point as well, and we'll get back to you if we can. Text us to 88291. We speak to Joaquim Pereira, the founder of PharmaDoctor, which provides clinical services into pharmacies, and his company has COVID-19 antibody tests, which they haven't yet got approval for. Hello to you.
Hello.
And also on the line, Chris Smith of Cambridge University, Radio 2's resident virologist. So just to say, I have got one of these tests in front of me, Joaquim. You can describe what you think I'm looking at, the different parts of it.
First of all, can I just ask, you said we don't have approval for these tests. PharmaDoctor has got approval from the MHRA, that's the Medicines Health Regulatory Authority, to supply these tests and market them to healthcare professionals in the UK and sell them to healthcare professionals. So these tests have been approved.
But they're not, okay, because my phrase was they haven't yet been approved by the government. That's correct, isn't it?
Yes, we don't even know if the government is evaluating this particular test, to be honest.
All right, because if they, presumably, once the government thinks your tests work really well, they will buy up loads and roll them out, but they haven't done that yet.
Potentially, we suspect that because our manufacturing partner produces very small amounts, we're talking about tens of thousands, that might not suit the government's volume requirement.
Understood. I'll interrupt only because I'm going to try this test in a second. But just to say, they are available in some pharmacies, aren't they, as well?
That's right. So we've supplied over 30,000, PharmaDoctor supplied over 30,000 of these tests to its clients, the pharmacies around the country. And they're already being used by the PharmaDoctor clients.
All right. So full disclosure, my recent medical history, I haven't had any time off work with any suspicion of COVID-19, nor has anyone in my family had a cough or fever, certainly since the start of the year. So on the basis of that, I don't think I've had it. But Chris Smith, you know, some people have it without knowing, don't they?
Yeah. Hi, Jeremy. How are you, Kim?
Hi. Yeah, good. Good. Thanks. What do you think about this?
Well, it is important for us to have some kind of testing of this type, and not just testing for individuals, but testing at scale. So I think there's two things. You mentioned that there are two types of tests, the have you got it right now and the have you had it type test. Well, I think the have you had it type test also sort of naturally falls into two. There's the have you had it type test that a person could do themselves. And then there's the have you had it type test that the government will need to do at scale in order to inform their mathematical models. Now, what you have in front of you is the have you had it type test that you can do yourself. It's slightly different to extrapolate this to a whole population. Because what we need to do in order to understand whether or not our guesstimates of how this virus has spread so far, how many people it's accessed, which sectors of society, which geographies have been worst and least hit, we've got some idea of that, but it's not very fine-grained. What we need to do is to get representative samples of blood from people all around the country and then test these at scale very, very quickly so that we can then build a picture of the country as it stands now. And this will inform the mathematical models that the government are using and help them to revise and explore various different scenarios for, right, what's our next step in this chess
game
order to de-escalate the lockdown.
All right, so we're on the more personal one of the have you had it? And I just want to make sure I do this right, Joaquim. So I've got your kit in front of me. I've got basically a sealed wrapper that contains the testing piece of plastic, which has got a sort of pad in it that I'll put my blood onto. I've got an alcohol pad. I've got some buffer liquid, whatever that is. And I've got, unfortunately, some sort of needle or spring loaded. I've just noticed the spring. That's going to be fun.
Yes, so you should have, it sounds like you have all the items in front of you.
So what do I take the alcohol pad first, right?
Yes, so you can clean the finger. It might be better to shake your hand that you're going to prick first.
Okay.
Shake that hand to generate a bit of
wristwatch
blood,
off, do you think?
Blood movement. No, that won't matter.
Okay, so I'll shake my hand and I'm shaking it downwards like this.
Yes, and then maybe get the finger, probably the wedding finger, so the second smallest finger is a good one to use.
Okay, so it's my right hand. I'll do the second smallest finger, and I'm taking out the swab.
Milk that so that the blood goes to the end of the finger.
Yeah,
so give it a slight massage.
Done that.
Then swab it.
I'm swabbing now.
You can use then the prick after that to...
Can I do it all but without having the prick? I can't do that. I just never like these. Do I pull the white cap off it? Is that right?
Yes, there's a sort of cylindrical white cap off it. You twist that and it will come off.
I'm doing... Okay, wait a sec. Because I don't have any written instructions here. Just twist it sideways. Oh, yeah.
Twist it and it just pulls off.
Oh, gosh. Okay.
Okay. Now, once you've done that, then it's ready to push against your finger.
Okay.
Once you've pushed it against your finger, then hold it down.
Oh, dear.
It doesn't really hurt that much.
Where's the local anaesthetic in this kit?
it's a very light prick.
All right. All right. Okay. Here we go. Oh, I hate this. Sorry. There's something. Usually when I do this, it takes me at least 15 minutes at home to get my courage. I'm gonna have to just do this. Okay. Oh, okay. That was fine. That's fine. Eesh. So
it was okay.
Yeah, it's fine. It's fine. So I've done that. It's gone in. That's fine. What do I do now?
So now you should have a drop of blood appearing.
Yes,
I do. Try not to touch that drop of blood, and maybe force a bit more by massaging that finger.
Okay. Got it.
And then hover it over the cassette
I should have opened the cassette first. Now I've got... All right, don't worry. It's not going to drip too much. Okay. So I've got the little thing that says S. Is that the...
Sample.
Sample.
Yes.
Is that where it has to drip?
Yes. And so drip it into there.
Doing it now. It's dripping. Hang on.
Okay.
Got a big drop coming. Wait a sec. It just won't come. Hang on. Of course, it's got a... Oh, dear. I missed.
Oh. Oh no.
Hang on. Oh dear. Can you just what happens?
You can use the lip of the sample area just to sort of
swish it. Yeah, okay. All right.
Yeah,
all right.
Sort of
I actually missed. How did I do that? Sorry guys. I tell you what, let me play some music. I'll get this sorted and then I'll come back to you. View to a Kill, and we are with Joaquim Pereira, the founder of PharmaDoctor, and also Chris Smith, the Radio 2 resident virologist. I managed it, guys. just to say.
I can't believe you managed to play View to a Kill while covering the studio in blood and stabbing yourself, all in the bargain.
That song describes exactly what the studio looks like now, actually.
Well, I was just thinking, that thought did occur to me.
Yeah. All right. Well, look, here's what's happened. I put the blood in there, it came out my finger. I put the buffer in, which is this other liquid that needs to go in to sort of swill it around. Joaquim, and I'm now looking, and I can't. All I've got really is a single red bar against the letter C. What does that mean? Are you there, Joaquim? Oh, we haven't got him. I'm in total suspense. What do you think it means, Chris?
Well, usually with these sorts of tests, you have a control band, which will be the C. And then you have the reaction band, which is what comes up as the second band if it is working and it's positive. That would be my speculation. Obviously, okay. I'm not familiar with that kit, but it's a bit like a pregnancy test.
You've done very well there.
Because you have one band that says it has definitely worked, and then another one which says it's worked and it's positive.
Okay, I think you're probably exactly right. We're going to get Joaquim back. I think his line's just dropped off. But yes, C I think means that the whatever amount of View to a Kill blood we got in there was sufficient. And the Joaquim, hi.
Hello.
You're leaving me in suspense here. No, not at all.
Yes.
So I've got a red line at C.
Yes.
What am I waiting for now?
So the C is control. So that means that the test has worked. We have to wait up to 10 minutes, really, for the test result to show a response on the IgG or on the IgM markers. So you should see, if it is a positive, you will see a line coming across either the IgG or IgM sections of the test, a bit like that control one, but it could even be just slightly faint.
Okay. What's the difference between the, so for people who don't understand, there's a tiny window no more than an inch long alongside that window, and there's sort of like almost elastoplast fabric below it, so it's obviously getting some sense of the blood that I put in here. Alongside the window, three markings. C we've established is control, so it's worked. There's a red line there. IgG and IgM are the other two potential markings. What is the difference there?
So IgM is your body's initial immune response. That's when your body is building antibodies that will help fight off that disease or virus that the body has contracted. After that, once the body has really started winning that fight, the IgM marker goes down, and as that happens, an IgG antibody is produced inside the body. That will help the body or the person fight off that virus if they come across it in the future. So the IgG is a far more prevalent, a far stronger antibody response that comes in at a later date, and that will stay with the body for up to 2 years potentially.
I see. Well, I'm going to take a guess here that I haven't had COVID-19 because I don't see anything appearing in this window. I may be proved wrong in 5 minutes' time. But Chris Smith, can I be sure of this kind of test, do you think?
It would depend on what we dub the sensitivity and specificity of the test. These are quite confusing terms, but basically what they translate into is, when a test says it's positive, is it really positive? And when a test says it's negative, is it really negative? And what we're looking for are values as high as possible. And Joaquim will know what the values are for his test, but we'd be looking for in the region of 98% for a good test that we know that 99% of the time we're therefore going to give someone the correct answer.
Yeah. And Joaquim, what sort of values would your test have?
So the values are close to what the government wants on this particular test. We have actually created some improvements to the test. And so later rounds of production are going to have an improved IgM specificity. The IgG is far better. It's running at 95 to 98%. The test samples that we've had have been small. So PharmaDoctor's partner, BioPanda, who makes these tests, they've run about 40 to 70 tests to actually gain those specificities on the results. We're looking to run longer, bigger tests to actually get more exact specificities and actual how a test works. Now, with that, with your result, if it comes up negative, it doesn't mean you didn't have the test, didn't have the virus. It just potentially means that you haven't gained enough antibodies for that virus, for that test to show up
Understood. But I think I would have known if I'd had it, because I'm of an age where I would have probably shown symptoms. So your test is not showing me that I've had it. I'm a bit disappointed because I sort of hoped that I might have had it and not noticed. Rachel texts and said, I would love to have the test to see I've had it, if I've had it. My GP says she thinks I did, but I can't get tested because I didn't end up going into hospital. I had a cough, a headache and a sore throat for 4 weeks. So if Rachel goes into her chemist, she can buy one of these, can she?
No, she can't. So this is another point I've got to make clear. At the moment, the tests are really only available for us to market to healthcare professionals and to sell for healthcare professionals. We've not advised healthcare professionals to sell them on to patients or to test patients, because currently advice from Public Health England is that if a patient has got symptoms, they should be self-isolating. Furthermore, PharmaDoctor is concerned that maybe if pharmacists started testing patients, that it wouldn't be in line with any national program. What advice would that pharmacist give? There needs to be a clear understanding of the exact performance of this test to know exactly what to advise, when to advise and when to test.
Understood. But presumably, Chris Smith, we want a test that tells us both things at the same time, whether you've had it and whether you've got it now.
Yes, and the benefit of actually the test you hold in your hand, by looking for IgM antibody and IgG antibody, it can get towards doing that. Because when a person is first infected, there will be a window period when they don't have IgM antibodies, but they come up pretty quickly. Within a week or so of infection, you're starting to make these IgM antibodies. So usually they're there when you're having the symptoms. So we can use that as a marker of acute infection. So rather than going to the, you called it the have I got it now test, the antigen test, rather than looking by a swab in the nose and throat, you can use the antibodies to infer that. Then if a person recovers from the infection, after about 3 to 4 weeks, you get what's called a class switch, and the IgM antibodies turn off, and IgG antibodies, which are much more specific, they're long-lived, and they're very robust, resilient immune response to whatever you've encountered, they kick in, and they're there like a permanent marker, actually for the rest of your life, although the levels will dwindle as you get older. And that tells you, you haven't got it now, but you have been exposed to this thing in the past. So we can use antibody tests as a guide towards what we haven't got, what we haven't had, what we have got, and what we're now immune to.
Thank you. Chris Smith of Cambridge University, Radio 2's virologist, and Joaquim Pereira, the founder of PharmaDoctor.
I would be complex. I would be cool. They'd say I played the field before I found someone to commit to. And that would be okay for me to do. Every conquest I had made would make me more of a boss to you. I'd be a fearless leader, I'd be an alpha type. When everyone believes ya, what's that like? I'm so sick of running as fast as I can, wondering if I'd get there quick or if I was a man. And I'm so sick of them coming at me again, 'cause if I was a man, then I'd be the man. In the work, they wouldn't shake their heads and question how much of this I deserve. What I was wearing,